SpaceX and Starship's role in NASA's Artemis program faces significant challenges due to an unexpected announcement from NASA. Shortly after this announcement, Musk issued a response. What exactly happened, and how did Musk react? In other recent news, SpaceX has achieved a remarkable new milestone in rocket reusability with the Falcon 9, in addition to reaching another significant milestone with the Starlink initiative. Simultaneously, NASA has made headlines for allegedly laying off a significant portion of its workforce. Let's discuss it all in today's episode of NR Studio. We're less than 2 years away from Artemis 3, the highly anticipated mission scheduled for 2027, which will return humans to the lunar surface for the first time in over half a century. This mission is crucial, not only for its symbolic significance as a return to the moon, but also because it could influence which nation will lead the new space race in the 21st century. SpaceX, along with its Starship Human Landing System, HLS, has been officially tasked with carrying out this historic mission. However, this arrangement could now be in jeopardy following a surprising new announcement from NASA itself, the agency that awarded the contract to SpaceX years ago. Recently, NASA Acting Administrator Sean Duffy made significant headlines by revealing a major shift in the agency's policy regarding the Artemis program. He indicated that NASA would invite new competitors to develop the HLS. At X, Duffy commented, "We're in a race against China, so we need the best companies working at a pace that allows us to get to the moon first." SpaceX holds the contract to build the HLS, which will transport U.S. astronauts to Artemis 3. However, competition and innovation are essential to maintaining our leadership in space. NASA is therefore inviting Blue Origin and other leading American companies to participate in the production of the HLS. In a subsequent message, Duffy stated, "A little competition is beneficial and stimulates innovation. American companies now have the opportunity to compete and see who can get us back to the moon first. We are determined to outperform China in this race, and we will do so under the direction of the president." From Duffy's comments, it's clear that NASA is laser-focused on the goal of being the first to return to the moon, especially amidst competition from China's increasingly advanced lunar efforts. In this competitive landscape, NASA seems convinced that SpaceX's progress on Starship hasn't met its expectations. In fact, when we analyze the Starship development timeline, there are concerning indicators. After 3 years of testing and 11 launches, Starship has made significant progress in demonstrating its essential systems.
These encompass in-orbit refueling, successful delivery of payloads to orbit, and controlled landings, which are crucial abilities needed for the Artemis 3 mission. At the present pace, it seems SpaceX will dedicate the initial months of next year to finalizing these targets, with the construction of refueling infrastructure projected to start in the middle of the year. This compressed schedule raises valid concerns regarding their preparedness for the 2027 goal. Furthermore, the substantial size and intricate design of Starship introduce additional difficulties. The sequence for landing on the lunar surface requires synchronization with various systems and spacecraft, rendering each test a complex and high-stakes endeavor. In light of these delays, Duffy's suggested approach is unique yet strategic. Instead of completely excluding SpaceX from the initiative, NASA is fostering competition to stimulate motivation and promote innovation throughout the sector. Blue Origin seemingly stands to gain the most from this shift in policy as it continues to work on its Blue Moon Mark 1 and 2 landers. Unsurprisingly, SpaceX and Musk responded swiftly to these comments. Musk, recognized for his bold and straightforward reactions, promptly countered. He declared, "They won't. SpaceX operates at lightning speed compared to other players in the space sector. Furthermore, Starship will handle the entire lunar mission. Remember what I said." When inquired about competitors like Blue Origin, Musk remained forthright. He noted, "Blue Origin has yet to deliver any payload to orbit, let alone the lunar surface." Beyond the immediate competition, Musk highlighted a long-term perspective that sets SpaceX apart from conventional lunar lander initiatives. He pointed out, "A permanently crewed scientific research base on the moon would be considerably more impressive than merely replicating what was achieved exceptionally well by Apollo in 1969. This represents his broader ideology. Achieving success on the moon should not simply focus on who is the first to arrive, but on who can remain and develop something enduring." Musk has persistently maintained that true success for the United States will be realized through establishing a lasting presence on the moon to serve as a platform for future exploration and colonization. However, it is equally valid that being the first to land carries notable strategic benefits. Achieving first place would allow NASA and SpaceX to secure the best locations for future installations and to establish critical precedents in lunar exploration and resource exploitation. Starship's enormous capacity presents distinct advantages in this context. Its capability to transport larger teams, heavier cargo, and necessary equipment might hasten the development of a lunar base. Additionally, Starship itself could be repurposed as part of that base, reducing costs and increasing efficiency. While Musk's statements are bold, ultimately actions will carry more weight than words. And for SpaceX to alleviate NASA's concerns, the company will need to showcase swift and steady advancements over the upcoming year.
This indicates the need to speed up the timeline for Starship's flights, conduct tests for orbital refueling, carry out reliable and safe landings, and get the HLS variant ready for full-scale missions on the moon. Consequently, the upcoming year will be crucial for SpaceX. Should they meet these technological targets, the organization may reaffirm its dominant position in human space exploration and strengthen its partnership with NASA within the Artemis program. However, if setbacks persist, NASA's choice to bring in competition might alter the power dynamics within the U.S. space sector. What are your thoughts on NASA's recent strategy? Do you think that introducing competition could advance the Artemis program? Or do you feel SpaceX could still be the exclusive supplier for the lunar landing system? Please express your opinions in the comments below, and don't forget to like the video and subscribe to our channel for more news as we track SpaceX's incredible voyage to the moon and beyond. In the meantime, as we anticipate Starship's next significant advancement, other parts of SpaceX are not delaying in showcasing their unmatched superiority. In two launches recently, Falcon 9 set not just one but two remarkable records that further establish SpaceX's prominence in reusability and satellite deployment. The first of these missions centered on launching 28 Starlink satellites into low Earth orbit. It took off from Cape Canaveral at 1:39 p.m. Eastern Time and successfully completed all aspects of its objective. However, the standout feature of this launch was booster B1067. After landing smoothly on the drone ship named A Shortfall of Gravitas, the booster achieved a remarkable total of 31 successful landings. This accomplishment not only sets a new record for SpaceX's reusable rocket initiative, but it also raises the bar for the entire international aerospace sector. It showcases impeccable engineering and consistent operations, a feat that no other company has matched to date. Even more remarkable, B1067's journey is far from finished. The booster is slated for recovery, refurbishment, and preparation for its next mission. With 9 additional launches needed to meet its ultimate target of 40 successful flights, it symbolizes the resilience and dependability that characterize SpaceX's Falcon fleet. The second record was established less than 2 hours later at the company's West Coast launch facility in California during yet another Starlink mission. While this launch didn't center on the reuse of boosters, it reached a significant benchmark in terms of satellite deployment. With the success of this mission, SpaceX has surpassed the milestone of launching over 10,000 satellites since the start of the Starlink initiative. It is essential to recognize that this number indicates the total satellites launched, and not all of them remain active today. Some have been deorbited due to being outdated or due to technical difficulties, leaving around 8,600 satellites currently functioning in orbit.
However, these figures represent a level of achievement unmatched by any other entity in human history. Both missions once again highlight the reliability, creativity, and aspiration that have shaped SpaceX's brand identity. Each successful launch advances their short-term goals while reinforcing their ultimate goal of developing a fully reusable and sustainable space transportation system. Meanwhile, as SpaceX continues its ascent, NASA is grappling with one of its most turbulent phases in recent memory. The Jet Propulsion Laboratory, JPL, long considered the core of NASA's robotic missions, has announced plans to lay off up to 500 people as part of a major reorganization initiative, raising questions about the future direction of JPL. These layoffs coincide with the ongoing government shutdown in the U.S. and the potential for the most significant budget cut in NASA's 66-year history. While more than 15,000 federal workers nationwide have been furloughed, NASA has clarified that these layoffs are not a direct result of the shutdown, rather they are part of a restructuring process that began in June. In its announcement, JPL stated, "To optimally position JPL for the future, we are implementing restructuring measures to ensure it is appropriately sized for future accomplishments. These layoffs will impact personnel across a range of areas, including technical, commercial, and administrative positions, with notices being sent to employees since October 14. JPL oversees many key science projects for NASA, such as the Psyche asteroid probe, Europa Clipper, the Euclid Space Telescope, the Perseverance Mars rover, and the Deep Space Network, which is crucial for interplanetary communications. In internal correspondence, JPL director Dave Gallagher acknowledged the challenges of this shift, commenting, "I understand that this requires a significant amount of change in a short time frame and will be difficult for our entire community. While not easy, I am confident that taking these steps now will enable the laboratory to grow at the scale and speed necessary to meet humanity's most ambitious endeavors in space." This is another wave of layoffs at JPL, following previous layoffs during the Trump administration that resulted in approximately 855 job losses and the termination of remote work for many staff. According to the BBC, 7 federal agencies are now facing more than 4,000 layoffs, prompting a union to file a lawsuit in federal court in Northern California. A small portion of NASA's workforce remains on duty to ensure operations on the International Space Station, track satellites, and advance the development of the Artemis Lunar Initiative. The full impact of these layoffs remains unclear, but many fear they could hinder the progress of vital projects and diminish NASA's standing in the field of space exploration. That's all for today's episode. See you in the next time.